Welcome to Token Show, the variety show about things that matter. I'm Lee C. Camp. This past February, all the team holed up inside Nashville's famed Sound Emporium, where for 3 days we welcomed some most outstanding musical guests and let the tape roll. Today, a full-length episode taped in one sitting during our time at the Sound Emporium, featuring one of Nashville's brilliant young bands, the New Respects, full of stellar songs. And beautiful nuggets of wisdom.
So I think learning to lean on your weakness is what brings us together.
All this coming right up. Hello friends, I'm Lee C. Camp, host of Token Show, the variety show honoring truth tellers, justice seekers, and those who do courageous acts of mercy. Today's episode features one of our live tapings captured at Nashville's famed Sound Emporium. The New Respects are a soul rock family band comprising Zandi Fitzgerald Morey, Darius Fitzgerald, and cousin Jasmine Mullen. They've released one full-length album entitled Before the Sun Goes Down, as well as an EP and a number of singles, well known for their high-energy live shows, and very pleased to have them today at the Sound Emporium. Welcome, guys.
Thanks for having us.
Great to have you here with us.
Sitting in the kitchen, eating yellow rice and chicken, watching Saturday morning cartoons.
Taste a little bland, need a little pepper, and Anna, can you pour me some juice?
Super hot comb, sitting on a hot stove, cause my mama trying to straighten my hair. She was within my ear, be a blessing, my dear. It's a different world out there. We're here. Stay here, and if you don't like it, that's fair, but we're here, gonna stay here, and we ain't going nowhere. We ain't going on, we ain't going on, we ain't going on, we ain't going nowhere. We ain't going on, we ain't going nowhere. No, 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 we ain't never going nowhere. 5 years old in my new school clothes, I was happy, I was ready to play. They were talking to each other, told me not to come to first. They said I couldn't be a part of the game.
Didn't realize till I got to senior high that I wasn't like the rest of the class.
I tried fitting in, but I just couldn't win. Can you let me do the math? Cause we're here, gonna stay here. And if you don't like it, that's fair.
Love it. Love it. It's great to have you here with us today at the Sound Emporium on a live token show, four or five years ago?
Yeah. It's been a minute.
Yeah, I think we were doing Bob Dylan stuff back
That's
in those
right.
days.
Yeah.
So it's great to have you here with us today.
Thank you. Thank you.
This the song you just did, first track on your first album, and it's definitely got a message.
It does.
Just a little bit.
And so I'm wondering, I mean, do you see that kind of like as an anthem for what you're doing in your artistic work?
I think so. Something that we like to do is always put a message in something that's fun.
Yeah.
So like the track and even the way we just kind of remixed it right there is musically really fun and then lyrically either encouraging or challenging to the listener wherever they fall.
Yeah.
So something that we just really believe in is who we are and the fact that we belong here. And it hasn't always felt like everybody's on the same page there. So writing a song about it, kind of about our history and then how we get to where we are now. Is something that not only was like healing in the songwriting process, but being able to sing it in all different rooms in front of all different people
yeah.
feels like a an important thing.
Yeah. I've heard it said that some songwriters that you take some small particular detail and that can then become a universal experience for a lot of people. Some like your line here, 5 years old in my new school clothes, I was happy, was ready to play. They were talking to each other, told me not to come no further, said I couldn't be a part of the game.
Yeah.
Was that a real live experience for one of you?
Yeah. It actually happened to my sister, Lexi. We went to a private school and predominantly white school, and she was in kindergarten and asked to play with some of her new friends, and they said that only people with their skin color were allowed to play.
Hmm.
And so that was an experience that kind of is like a metaphor on even the whole song of We Ain't Going Nowhere. It's like wanting to be a part of good things in the world, and but not always seeing people that look like us.
Yeah.
So instead of using those things as reasons to fall back, it's more so reasons to stay, even when it's hard.
Yeah.
And now we play lots of games together with a lot of people who welcome us from all different walks of life. Yeah. So.
That reminds me, there was this famous guy, Clarence Jordan, who started in the 1930s and 40s, he started an kind of height of segregation. He started a interracial community, intentional community in Georgia. They came to be known as Quinineo Farms. And he believed in three things, especially he and the folks that started the community. One was nonviolence from the Sermon on the Mount. One was breaking down segregation. And three was common ownership of goods. And they just got, death threats, bomb threats all the time, economic boycotts. But I remember one time one of the interviewers said to him, when they were under this grave threat and constantly every night having to deal with bomb threats and stuff, somebody came to him and they said, "Why don't you just leave?" And he said, "Because that would be a disservice to our community. We're staying here and we're not going anywhere." And so I love the y'all's lyrics and how that resonates with that beautiful story.
It's awesome. I love
that. Yeah. When you think about that kind of message, what were moments in which you became conscious of differences that you were having to learn to navigate?
I feel like we were very privileged where it kind of took a while. We were in a church. We grew up in a church that was like super diverse. And we had a lot of people that we call aunt and uncle that do not look like us at all. So I think because we had that layer of love and acceptance, we were, or at least for me, I was kind of, jaded isn't the right word, but like
naive
to that there were differences. Or like, I remember I was like 13 and told my mom, like, "Mom, racism is a thing of the past. Like, we're done
with
that.
That's from your time.
That's from y'all." And then I got older and realized that even subtle things to like being followed around in stores and things like we were taught to always have your receipt on you, always like don't run around in the store, don't do anything bad because they're going to come for you pretty much. And then you kind of start to realize like, dang, there are some differences. But for me, I have a ton more love and acceptance memories than the negative.
Yeah.
That could just be me looking that way, though.
Putting an emotional connection. He's working on not numbing.
Jasmine, when you think about learning about that, becoming conscious of that, what was that like for you?
Elementary school for me was kind of what Darius was saying, where I went to this school that feels super special to me now. That was super diverse, kind of on purpose. So there was a lot of kids in my class who looked like me and a lot that didn't. And my church was the same way because we all grew up in the same church. And my parents themselves, like my mom's black and my dad's white. So there was something in me that was like, this is just the world. Like the world is like mixed and everybody loves each other. And then I went to high school and I was like one of two black people in the school. And my experience of life was vastly different than my classmates' experience. Everyone was kind, but we almost didn't speak the same language in terms of our history and the things that we had grown up learning. And it was the first time I really noticed like, oh, like I'm a little bit different. And as you become an adult too, the way that society views you is different too. And so just like going from being this cute little mixed girl to being now society views me as a black woman, and like where I have grown up thinking that's a beautiful thing, other people don't always think that. And like the things that they have assumed of me haven't always been beautiful things. And that was like hard for my brain to kind of wrap around because of the environment of like love and like beauty that I grew up in as a child.
Thanks for sharing that. Yeah. Zanny, what about your early consciousness of this?
Yeah. Similar to Darius and jazz, like where we grew up was a piece of heaven on earth. And so it felt like, I mean, this church was like one Sunday we would be doing worship in Spanish. The next Sunday there would be a Native American family who would lead worship. And then it would be like a normal, like a CCM setting. And it was never like a special production. Yeah. It was just what we did. Mm. And coming from that world to the pendulum swing of like a lot of separation in church and a lot of people's own opinions that I just didn't realize were there. I think the most I've struggled with it has been in the music industry and less in like relationship, because I've been blessed with like friends who just, if they don't know, they ask, and then they just love me really well. But kind of seeing like when you tour and people are like, oh my gosh, like I've never seen anything like this before. And I'm like, really? Like I mean, we predominantly female, all black band is way more rare than I assumed. Mm. And so having to face, I would say ignorance, not in a malicious way, but literally like people who don't have exposure. Right. Yeah. In the music industry and still having to come up against like, you're the first whatever that I've seen sometimes feels archaic and less like celebratory.
Yeah.
And so in that dynamic, you're like, I don't necessarily want to be your first experience because of the year that we're in. So, like Derry said, we were taught with an awareness of like how we have to navigate the world as black people. But I think I've struggled with it the most in my adulthood and realizing like there's still a lot of firsts that I have to be the one to like go and do. And that is way more shocking than it is not, because we grew up with so much love.
Tell us about this next song you're going to do.
What You Really Want is about hiding emotionally. And it's kind of our invitation for people to be like, hey, like, if it's a good day or if it's a bad day, like, I'm here to stick around. But tell me what you want and I'll do that. Mm-hmm. Our best to be like a good friend, I would say.
Are you feeling good? You can tell me if you're not.
Feeling happy, I'll be happy too.
It's okay if you're not just giving me what you got, cause I'm in it with you. Oh, tell me what is on your mind, if that's what you really want. Tell me what is on. Thank you.
love it. You know, I do a lot of reading and teaching my college students on various practices of human flourishing. There's been all sorts of research in the last couple of decades on that one key to growing into a mature, flourishing human being is the capacity to talk about emotions. Mm-hmm. I didn't grow up with that. I mean, I was kind of like, I remember probably 15 years ago, I was sitting in therapy and this therapist said to me, he said, what are you feeling? And I said, I don't know. Yeah. And he looked at me and he said, I think you're telling the truth. And so I think this is a great song. It's this invitation to a sort of vulnerability and intimacy, which is a wonderful way to grow relationships pretty quickly as well.
Yeah, no doubt.
But what's some of the background on that particular song for you?
It's funny because the more that we play these songs live and the more that people kind of tell us their interpretation of it, the more meaning they have. Mm. And I think we wrote that one actually with our friend Alvin Love, and it was just about saying something like, how can we be honest and how can we make something feel cool? But now, I mean, I was probably 21 when I wrote that, and I'm 26 now. So over the time, like, you kind of realize what you wrote the more that you live life. Mm. And it's why we write the way that we do, because we need our songs first. And so there's been a lot of therapy, band conversations, vulnerability that we've had to learn over the years so that we could be a healthy band.
Yeah.
And a healthy band is just made up of healthy people.
Yeah.
So kind of went first in that.
That's great. Thanks for sharing that. So what are some things that you've learned about how better to relate to each other that you've kind of thought we need to put this in place in our group dynamic?
I feel like we're kind of opposites. Jasmine and I, we are like naturally listeners. So I had to learn to speak more. Hmm. And Zandy is naturally a talker. So
there's a better way to say it. There's a... I think he means leader.
Oh my gosh.
So I think learning to lean on your weakness is what brings us together.
Wait, say that again. Learning to lean on your weakness. Tell us more what you mean by that.
I think that's just where the good stuff happens. Like, I limit myself sometimes by listening all the time. And I think sometimes it is a strength. I think it is a strength to be able to listen and hear people's points of view, but also realizing people need my point of view as well. So in that, it creates, you're being vulnerable off the bat because nobody wants to be like struggling in front of your peers.
Right.
Yeah.
So that builds like trust in each other. And then I have good ideas sometimes and that needs to be heard. So I think that has been huge in like developing our trust and our chemistry with one another.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Learning to lean on your weakness is a great line. I think I'll have to steal that one. There. That's really good.
That just came to me. Learning to lean.
So Darius and Zandy, you guys grew up in a pastor's home?
Yes.
Yeah. What do you think about that experience? I've heard you say that it was somewhat of a sheltered experience.
Yeah.
But what contributed out of that experience to the work that you're getting to do today?
Darius nodded for me to answer.
Darius, lean on your weakness over there.
Yeah, come on, Darius.
That's good. I think there's healthy things and there's unhealthy things. We kind of grew up on a stage, kind of, just because dad's pastor, so everybody knows us and everybody's watching. So I think that can breed a natural sensitivity and being aware of yourself, which is healthy.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, sometimes that turned into performance. And unfortunately, that makes me a great performer on stage, but it's not a great, like, it doesn't make me a great friend because you have to be that. You have to be honest with people. So if I'm just giving people what they want all the time, that's not like bringing myself to the table fully.
Yeah.
And they're just getting like a weird version of me.
Mm.
But yeah, that's a lesson that I'm still wrestling with and still having to figure out. But for sure, that's been one. And yeah, Zandy will take it from here.
I think God is something that he's the work that we're doing. You know, like we grew up with an understanding of who God was pretty early. And then as we got older, encountering him for ourselves and kind of figuring out, like, what was religion? What was relationship? And I think we probably still on that journey of undoing and relearning and less like deconstruction and more just like relationship. How do we know why we do what we do instead of just doing it mindlessly? When you're put on stage and when you have to perform, and Jasmine's always talking about being responsible with the words that we put in people's mouth, because these are songs that hopefully the world will sing with us. There is an awareness that we need in order to say, like, okay, if we wrote "We Ain't Going Nowhere" out of anger, we would be putting anger in the mouths of the masses. The masses.
One day.
Yeah. Or if we just wrote "What You Really Want" out of a place of not vulnerability, but like performance, and like, oh, I'm good and you're good and we can be good together, then we would be putting performance in the mouths of people. And so I think the awareness of the why and why we write the lyrics we write, and even if we don't, like I said, we don't know what the songs will become or what they'll mean to other people, we do know what we meant when we planted joy and happiness and resolve and redemption into songs. And then we just kind of see what is blooming out of that.
So Jasmine, you grew up in a kind of classic contemporary Christian music home, right? Your mother, Nicole, very popular performer, your dad, producer. What do you, when you look back and think about what kind of contributing factors you got to your work you're doing today, what are kind of things that stand out for you?
Yeah. So my whole life, I swore I would never be a musician because my parents are obviously both musicians, but I grew up and there would be like writing sessions going on in my house all the time. And if I was with my dad, I was usually in the studio and my mom was always singing. And so I think I kind of came by it honestly.
Yeah.
And I think that there's like a level of messiness I haven't always allowed in my work because I have seen so much like professionalism in that. So there's been like a lot of undoing and learning, it's okay, like, if everything isn't perfect when you write a song. Like, you don't have to, like, it have to be, like, a Grammy-winning song for it to be a song. But I also feel like, I don't know, there's something really special about the fact that I got to grow up in, like, a master class. Like,
yeah, really.
Just, like, watching. My parents are really great writers, and I just got to be around that all the time. And being around that by osmosis, I think, made me value words in a way that, like, I don't know what my life would be like if I hadn't been raised by them. So yeah, I think I definitely am a musician today because of them.
Yeah.
And
I like the distinction I heard you kind of working with there between when I've always tried to identify perfectionism on the one hand as I've increasingly learned is unhelpful to me, while a striving for excellence is quite helpful, right?
Totally.
Important. And that perfectionism can really undercut excellence, I think.
Right? Yeah, telling.
Yeah, that is.
Yeah. That's me.
Don't be in my life.
I'm just going to type that in my notes.
Right.
Perfectionism can undercut excellence.
Yeah.
Now for a new recurring segment featuring a review of a book that will help you live life well. Here's my friend and fellow Nashvillian and academic, Dr. David Dark.
There are no shortcuts to learning how to love your neighbor. That's a quote from the poet, novelist, and English professor Daniel Bowman in his gift of a book, On the Spectrum, Autism, Faith, and the Gifts of Neurodiversity. With stunning vulnerability and disarming prose, Bowman introduces himself while also opening a door to the wisdom and witness the neurodiversity movement has for us. His book is a timely offering for anyone seeking a life of visionary wholeness while trying to manage and endure what he refers to as the onslaught of unwanted input. Bowman received an autism diagnosis at the age of 35 and is quick to claim his singularity, his way of processing and interacting with the world, as something that defies compartmentalization. As the saying goes, if you've met one autistic person, you've met one autistic person. I commend his book to you as a way to better know yourself. He speaks with prophetic authority on the work of learning to love oneself. Ancient wisdom assures us that this is the clearest path to loving someone else. As he tells his own story, It's as if he's holding open a door for understanding the wide variety of interior lives we encounter if we dare pause long enough to really look and listen to one another. Listen to how Bowman puts it as he considers his diagnosis. He says, "The name autism comes from the Greek autos, which means self. The ism means a state of being, so autism connotes the isolated self. In many ways, I wholly identify with that connotation." Bowman goes on to use the etymology of the word in a profound way. He says, "Yet, I would like to claim the literal meaning as a new home for what I was and am. The word autism, in its purest form, actually means the state of being oneself. There's a larger issue of authenticity here, one that I would need and still need to keep living into." This is where Bowman holds his diagnosis near to his anointing as an artist, as someone who hopes to expand the stock of available reality. "Don't mistake my fidgeting and lack of eye contact for disinterest," he writes. "I often can't sustain eye contact and shouldn't have to. To flourish, I must feel safe at the gut level." Here again, poet that he is, Bowman finds the words that find the difficult feeling of dis-ease, challenging the reader to think harder about what we owe each other in our interactions, what signals we send, whether consciously or unconsciously. The Jamaican-American poet June Jordan says poetry means taking control of the language of your life. By giving voice to both his anxious moments and his triumphs, Bowman exemplifies what taking up this task looks and feels like, while also inviting us to bear witness alongside him to the minute particulars of human being. By picking up what he's setting down, we're enjoined in the work of dwelling more knowingly in our own existence. Receive his voice.
You're listening to Tokens, Public Theology, Human Flourishing, and the Good Life. We're most grateful to have you joining us. If you've not yet done so, subscribe today to the Tokens podcast on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, CastBox, or wherever you get your favorite podcasts. We do love hearing from you. Always pleased to hear some of the things you'd like to hear more about. You can email us at podcast@tokenshow.com. Also, remember, you can sign up for our email list or find out how to join us for a live event, all at tokensshow.com. Lots of great live events coming up soon. Check it out. Come join us and see us here in Nashville. This is our episode with the New Respects, live from Nashville's famous Sound Emporium. Part two in just a moment. Welcome back to Token Show and our interview with the New Respects at the Sound Emporium in Nashville. So, Cindy, I think you mentioned the word deconstruction a moment ago.
Yeah.
It's obviously common, and even maybe more so these days, for 20-somethings and 30-somethings to be doing a lot of deconstruction. And then you bring together with that the fact that as a Black band, you've also are having to navigate that one of the reasons so much deconstruction is going of American Christianity is because of failures, historic injustices that are a part of the story of American Christianity. So what's it like for you guys to process some of that stuff, the deconstruction stuff, the sharp questioning stuff these days?
Huge question.
It's a doozy.
Yeah,
I was a doozy. Man, it's tough because there's a lot of information out that we didn't always have, and there's a lot of different viewpoints that are out there. But certain things, you just got to have faith and be like, all right, I believe this, even if it's messy, and roll with it. I think my parents' generation did that really well out of, necessity. And, my grandparents for sure had to. There was no time for questioning. Mm. But now we have lots of time to question. And so sometimes we do. But at the end of the day, you can question forever, I think. So you kind of just have to get to, a point where you look at the mess that's in front of you. Where's the truth? Let me grab that and roll and just keep
I think there's something in the Black culture in general that's had to have faith beyond outcome. And that is something that is passed down from generation to generation. So it's not, so the questions feel less threatening to my faith, but they're more working out the faith. And so it's not like if this doesn't come out right, then I'm throwing everything away. And more like, I just don't know how this makes sense in within this. Mm-hmm. And for me, a lot of the questioning has become is more around tradition than it is who God is, and seeing how it all settles while knowing I won't know how it all settles, you know? So there's this like balance that you have to have of not being a mindless believer, someone who just takes what everything's what everybody says, but at the same time, not trying to play God and figure out and answer everything when we have our proper place in understanding.
I would make up that in your role, you might have a sense of sometimes feeling a pressure to say something about social issues, social justice issues, because of the role you're in. So how do you navigate that? Are there times you think, I just want to play my music and say what I have to say in my music? Or are there times you think, I really should speak up about X, Y, or Z?
It's every day. I think the crazy thing is, no matter what we do, we're kind of saying something. We're in this field that we stick out in. We're playing this music that people don't expect us to play. So just by walking on stage, we're saying something. But sometimes you got to use, you have to go past your songs and say something with your words. And that's always, it's a weird thing because social media has made it weird because everybody feels like they're kind of like
an activist
at this point. And I think there is something to letting people play their strengths in that. Like, everybody's not going to be MLK Jr. Jr.
Yeah.
Even though sometimes they think they are. So I kind of, the opposite of what I said earlier, kind of lean on, like, honestly, them and be like, should we say something? If we should, how should we say it? And if we shouldn't, we shouldn't. It's just like every chance is different. Every opportunity is different.
Yeah.
At the top of 2020, there is a lot of opportunity for us to speak. A lot of people, with the awareness of where the world was, also, I don't want to say they remembered that we were a band who was in a world of, in the Christian world, all Black. And they're like, that is the perfect person we need on our podcast, essentially. And we said no a lot.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Because there's a difference between opportunity and responsibility. And we have to be really careful with like what and who we're responsible for. And in that moment, there was so much grieving we had to do. There was so much hurt. There was so much pressure, too, to say the right thing, that it was more wise for us to just be who we are than to go out and, like, teach at the time. Mm-hmm. And so now, 2 years later, there's more opportunity for us and me specifically to talk about what these things look like, what 2020 meant for me. But I think, honestly, that's a year that I'll probably be processing for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
Just because it was so intense.
Right.
So it's a blessing and a curse, kind of having the thing where it's like us being here is saying something. In a lot of ways, it means we don't have to say something.
Yeah.
And then in some ways, it means that we do. So through like communication, again, therapy, like us talking about like, are we healthy enough to go public?
Yeah.
Because that's very different than like healthy enough to talk about it in private.
Right.
And then prayer and a lot of guessing.
Yeah. Jasmine, what's that like for you in the potential pressure of feeling like you have to speak up about stuff?
Kind of like what Zanny was just saying. I feel like I have a different responsibility to the people in my life than I do to the potential masses sometimes. So there's been a lot of conversations I've had in private, and then there are some that I will have in public. And those can't always happen simultaneously as I'm processing and learning who's safe. And but it doesn't mean that I don't talk about it. It just means the way in which I talk about it might be a little bit different, because this isn't like a topic in which I'm not heavily involved, like that hasn't like deeply painted my life in some way. And so it's like, okay, like I'm going to talk about this today, but the way I talk about it with Zandy is going to be different than I talk about it with somebody else.
Yeah. Tell us about this next song you're going to do. I think you're going to do Say What You Want.
This one is about being who you are, no matter what people say about it. And we also wrote this one with Alvin Love a while ago and then kind of dug it back up and finished it. And it just became a really sweet anthem of not only like beyond race, but just more about people liking who we are in a world where it feels like you have to become somebody else in order to like who you are. Yeah. This one, actually Jasmine, when we wrote it, she was like, "This, let's put something in people's mouths where they can say, I like who I am."
Okay, so I don't know if I'm remembering the quote correctly, but I think it was Erasmus, 16th century Renaissance humanist, who said something like that the zenith of happiness is to be at peace with oneself.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, that's say what you want. I like who I am.
Yeah.
What's kind of the journey of getting to be able to sing a song like that and somewhat mean it?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Sometimes I feel like you sing it.
Yeah, no doubt.
For sure.
Which is why I feel like feeling so strongly about putting those specific words in people's mouths, because I think what you say over yourself has so much power that it doesn't mean that immediately you're going to be like, oh my gosh, I'm just a fire. But like the things that we say about ourselves are the things that our brain believes about ourselves. Mm-hmm. And I feel like as much as it's been a journey for us to come to like ourselves, like we've sang that. Or I sang that before I believed it about myself.
Hmm.
And now I do. And so I think it's just like powerful to say, even if you don't believe it yet.
Yeah. It's like you've given people an affirmation.
Yeah.
Exactly. That can be a gift to them.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's sweet. Who are some people you guys admire? If you have your own little hall of saints, who would be in your hall of saints that you like who they are?
That's a good question. I don't want to just say something random, but just like,
I mean, off the top, if we go Bible vibes, Paul is like wild to me.
Yeah.
Why so?
To go that hard in the paint on both sides.
A quick out of studio voiceover. One of our producers notes that this is the first ever basketball metaphor we've had on the show. And I confess I had to look it up on Urban Dictionary. Hard in the paint means to approach a problem with supreme confidence, to be fully committed, and is rooted in basketball parlance. It's an attempt to score by employing all your strength and commitment to drive into the painted area, which is typically crowded and hotly contested right under the goal. In case you needed to know, like I did.
I think it shows kind of that God doesn't want us to change who we are necessarily. He wants us to be who we are with him. Because Paul was wild out there. He was hard in the paint, killing people. And then he's like, oh, I'm wrong. I'm going to go hard in the paint, saving people. And I think that's a beautiful picture of what we should be like.
Yeah.
I think there's more beauty and more colors. So when we bring fully ourselves to the table, that's when like the magic happens.
Yeah. Thanks.
My mom was the first person to come to mind. I know her pretty well, but yeah. I think her story is one of a lot of trials, a lot of loss, a lot of devastation, and yet one, a lot of joy, a lot of choosing. Like she is the clearest picture of choosing joy, choosing the life that she wanted in spite of kind of every obstacle that could be was, you know, and I was born into a lineage of that choice. First being salvation, but then also just like being happy. Like we grew up dancing in the house all the time because it's mom wanted community that we could love, you know, growing up. And so she made the big things very practical to me. And that's why I'm like, our biggest thing in music is making people feel good. We want people to say like, I don't know, I just felt so happy listening to you guys. And it's like, because that is what's missing a lot in the world. And so I admire that, like, she did it first.
Yeah.
And now we get to be a part of doing it for others.
Yeah, that's sweet. Jasmine, how about you?
I also know mine, but my grandma, Grams, is like, I think she's never sinned. Like, she's literally one of those people who I'm like, I think you've never messed up in your life. But she is just like the epitome of a kindness that doesn't look for approval. Like, she finds out that you have a need and she meets it, but she like doesn't let you know that she's the one who's done it. And she like, she didn't grow up with much. She didn't have much in her early adult years, but she's still like one of the most generous people that I've ever met. She's like allowed the things that have been hard in her life to make her lean into God and lean into love for other people. And I just want to be just like her because she's just the epitome of grace to me.
Yeah, that's a lovely picture. So musical styles, evolution of musical styles, you started as a sort of indie folk, Mumford and Sons-esque, perhaps.
Man, oh my gosh, yes. Your homework.
And then, so what kind of been your route to where you are now musically, or how do you think about musical influences and styles that have shaped you?
Well, the Mumford thing, so I tell the story that we were trying to be the black version of Mumford and Sons, and then I pick up an electric guitar and everything kind of shifted for us. And over the years, I mean, it really is very parallel with like how we grow as people. I think you're more comfortable being honest about the music you want to make when you're sure of the person that you are. And so over the years, the evolution has been one that is less trying to mimic what is successful and just trying to be good humans. And in that, like for me, who I am ends up being heard through how I play.
Yeah, that's great.
Versus me being like, how did they do that? And I do that exact same thing. You end up hearing like my story in my guitar playing and in my writing. So, and then over the time, we grew up in a lot of white environments and we kind of were trying to figure out how do we fit in. And we've stopped doing that. And we've more leaned into like what we naturally would do and then letting it land where it lands. And that hopefully will sound like the music we make this year will hopefully sound different than the music we make 5 years from now, because that evolution process will continue and we'll be able to be even more honest than we are today.
It's kind of like your song, I Like Who I Am, then manifests itself in these new ways.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's lovely. Well, we've been talking to Zandy Fitzgerald, Darius Fitzgerald, and cousin Jasmine Mullen, who constitute the new respects here at the Sound Emporium. It's really been lovely to have y'all here with us today.
Thanks for having me.
So you got one more song you're going to do for us.
We do.
Maybe something of a change as well? A love song?
A love song, a different... It, you know, now that I'm thinking about it, it wasn't written as
it
a love song.
No.
You matter. It does. I think sometimes we're learning to phrase things in a specific way because love is a universal language.
Yes.
But this song was written more about like a family dynamic of, think prodigal son. Like someone who had run away, someone who had been like, hey, like I'm out.
Mm-hmm.
And this person, from our perspective, we're singing about saying like, you matter more than the tension. So just come home.
I think that's the cool thing about songs, though, because as someone who helped write it, it was always in my head, just like friends, friendship. Mm-hmm. I think, yeah, sometimes friendship gets slept on, but we need friends.
Indeed.
And I think I would hope someone would sing this song to me if I was kind of doing my own stuff.
I can't pretend you never made me sad, but you should know that I'm not mad. How bad do I miss you? Bad. Love you more than you could understand. Left the front door open, I want you back home. Now we can talk it over. Even left the food out, and when things get hard, we'll find something to laugh about. Nothing matters more than you matter to me. Oh, you matter to me. I know you don't wanna live in pain. Don't even have to explain. It sucks to be lonely. Company is holy. Home's wherever you're with me. Left the front door open, I want you back home. Now we can talk it over. Even left the food out, and when things get hard, we'll find something to laugh about. Nothing matters more than you matter to me. Oh, you matter to me. Oh, come back, would you come back home? Come back, would you come back home? Come back, would you come back home? Let the front door open, I want you back home. Now we can talk it over. Even left the food out, and when things get hard, we'll find something to laugh about. Nothing matters more than you matter to me. Oh, you matter to me.
You've been listening to Token Show, Public Theology, Human Flourishing, and the Good Life. Remember, you can subscribe to our podcast on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your favorite podcasts. We'd love for you to go over there and give us one of those 5-star glowing reviews as well. Got feedback? We'd love to hear from you. Email us at podcast@tokenshow.com. Our thanks to all the stellar team that makes this podcast possible. Executive producer and manager Christy Bragg of Bragg Management. Co-producer Jacob Lewis of Great Feeling Studios. Associate producers Ashley Bain and Tom Anderson. Music director Tim Lauer. Engineering by Carriott Harmon. And special thanks to our live engineer at the Sound Emporium, Joe Trentacosti, and all his friends taking good care of us here at the Sound Emporium. Thanks for listening, and peace be unto thee. Tokens Podcast is a production of Tokens Media LLC and
Great Feeling Studios.
Oh.